I in fact remember the first day I came to the high school. We had a subject that was called the visual arts or something like that. And there was a special room that was really, really dark. And the professor who was teaching, she just set us all there in the room, and she turned off all the lights, and she was just projecting paintings and images of architecture, right? And then paintings again, and she was projecting, and the whole hour passed, and she was hoping that we will learn something from that. Of course, I was at that time really, really stupid, so I didn't learn anything from that. But I remember that, and she was hoping that we will somehow catch this aesthetics, this visual appreciation of beauty, of nice paintings, of nice architecture and everything. At that time I couldn't catch it, but I still remember the idea. So my lecture will be sort of that type of lecture. I will try to get you appreciate some beauty if possible. Guy already told you that when we are dealing with scientific visualization, most of us really think that we can do everything that is required, right? Because the visualization is there as something that we do for a living, right? We draw data, we plot graphs, we do three-dimensional visualization if needed, and it's not something that anybody should be telling us about how to do it, right? And if you take a look at the definition of scientific visualization, they're kind of weak. They're not something that you hope for. Like it says, scientific visualization is an interdisciplinary branch of science, according to Friendly, primarily concerned with the visualization of three-dimensional phenomena, architectural, meteorological, medical, biological, etc., where the emphasis is on realistic renderings of volumes, surfaces, illumination sources, and so forth, perhaps with a dynamic time component. It's somehow too simple. Scientific visualization is much more than that, although this kind of gets the basic idea, but it's also considered a branch of computer science that is a subset of computer graphics. The purpose of scientific visualization is to graphically illustrate scientific data to enable scientists to understand, illustrate, and glean insight from their data. You know these weird guys with bicycles who are constantly talking about bicycles. My bicycle can really run fast. I bought myself a new bicycle. My bicycle has new tires. I run my bicycles for 100 kilometers and it's like new, and they are constantly speaking about bicycles, right? Yet we normal people, right, we use bicycles to drive around. We don't speak too much about them. Well, these people that constantly talk about bicycles are like these people who are doing scientific visualizations. They're expert on that, right? But you really don't want to hear all these stories about bicycles. You just want to drive your bicycles as much as possible. And but from time to time, you can really get on with the advice from those people. They can tell you what's wrong with your bicycle. But although they're not looking at the scenery and at the mountains and at the clouds and at the clear skies, they can tell you what's wrong with your bicycles. So I'm the guy who drives a bicycle because of beauty of nature, but from time to time I can repair the bicycle, right? So I will tell you a little bit of how normal guy who drives a bicycle can repair it sometimes, okay? So there are, in this world of bicycle drivers, of people who drive bicycles and constantly talk about them, they have some sort of divisions between what sort of a bicycle they like. And okay, I'm too much into this bicycle analogy, okay? So scientific visualization is something that is called visualization of physical data. People are usually visualizing something real, something from the real world of dangerous a planet, a bug, or something like that. While the InfoVis or information visualization is a visualization of data which is abstract. I think the guy was talking mostly about this InfoVis aspect of visualization. So the basic idea is this. This community is mostly populated with computer graphics people, and this community is mostly populated with people who design computer interfaces, like human-computer interaction people. So they are thinking of the ways how to cleanly represent the data that can be easily manipulated, while these people are mostly thinking about new ways to visualize the static, mostly static data. So let me give you an example of a typical information visualization. So that's something I just got from the Scopus webpage. When you put in your paper, right, and then it analyzes the references of your paper. And in the middle it says this is your paper, and then by coding the references that you have in there by color and by size. In this case, the size is the number of citations of the paper that you are citing. So by examining your own paper you can see, look at this, this was the paper that has the most cites that I cited. There is a sort of a interesting representation of the bibliographical data in your paper. It's a typical example of information visualization. It's not something physical. It's just processing the abstract data through the visual machinery. So you're processing the data that was not meant to be visualized through the visual machinery. And in that way, you can sometimes get a better appreciation of the data. It's very often. That's why you do it, right? So there is a story in this scientific visualization community which goes something like this. Imagine you're writing a paper on the yellow butterfly that you just discovered. And you don't have any means of visualizing the butterfly. You cannot illustrate him, you cannot photograph him. Yeah, the journal that you are going to publish in does not publish illustrations and photographs. So you are trying to describe your finding using only words. So imagine describing the yellow butterfly that you discovered with only words. It would be completely impossible. Why? Because the language is not really suited to describe all the visual richness that we have. It's some things are impossible to describe. You just need a photograph, right? Because the amount of information that we are getting from the visual system, right, it's so huge that it's almost impossible to encode it in certain language patterns that we define, like spotted, like yellow, like red, like triangle, right? It's almost impossible. So you would really need to visualize this butterfly in order to show it to some other people. You could do it in this way. You could take a photo and say, well, this is the butterfly that I discovered. But that would not really be a scientific visualization. It would be a nice photograph. This would probably be a scientific visualization. So you're not just writing a paper about the butterfly that you discovered, but you're putting it in some wider context, right? This butterfly has something to do with other butterflies. This butterfly is somehow related to something that I thought would be important, whatever. But as soon as you make a sort of a visual statement like this, you are invoking people to think, to discover patterns, to discover repetitions, to discover universalities, to discover differences from one thing to another. And this would be a scientific visualization. You are obviously trying to say something here, and you are invoking the reader to join you, right? So this is more than just a photograph. You are making a statement here, right? It was a completely random reference that I've chosen. It just had to do with butterflies, but this is a nice example of it. So, with scientific visualization, you usually want to say something. You usually want to make some point using images. Well, that is the reason why we do it, right? There are essentially two reasons why we do the scientific visualization. The first one is to explore the thing that we are visualizing, to reveal certain things visually, to understand in that way, right? I had a student who used to come to me and tell me, well, listen, I have just discovered today this, it's really, really good thing. When I did this and when I did that and when I calculated this, it turned out to be like, I was saying, well, come on, I want to see that, right? So when you're communicating with someone, you want him to show to you, listen, this is what I did in this graph, this is what I found out. You don't want to speak about it. So you want to extract patterns and you want to induce insight through the visualization. You want to induce thinking about things through visualization. And it's all called the exploration of things. And once you explore it, you want to be sure that the other people will get it. So you want to present it to other people. And by presenting information visually, you're really compressing the information. The yellow story butterfly. Imagine if I had to tell all the things about the yellow butterfly or about the pattern of compression of thin disk. If I draw the pattern of compression in a certain way, then it will be understood by all who read it, right? I'm compressing huge number of information in an image for presentation, right? I could use it also as a map or as a reminder. When I'm speaking to some other people, I just take it out and say, listen, look at this thing here. It's a sort of a reminder, a map. It's a tool for communicating to others, right? Or for reminding myself about things. And in that way, I'm, of course, conveying information. I'm propagating the things that I found out in my research. So the scientific visualization is used for exploration and for presentation. So, of course, scientific visualization is important part of the research itself. How many times did you code something, right, and then it produced a huge amount of data, and then you didn't know what to do with it, then you visualized it, then you started rethinking it again, then you change the parameters of the system or you change your Hamiltonian or whatever, and then again you produce a huge amount of data which you then again visualize. So the scientific visualization is a natural piece in this process of research. You're doing it all the time, although you're not thinking about that in that way, but as soon as you do plot something dot that in GNU plot, right, you're doing this. You're visualizing the data. So the scientific visualization is an important component of research. It's not just something that you do to show to others. Eventually you will show it to others, right? But after many circles of this. So, actually we understand by seeing. We give a lot of confidence to our visual system. And through scientific visualization, we engage this visual machinery. which we put much confidence into. Of course, it was evolutionary perfected to give us a detailed and reliable information. Right, imagine a lion coming for you and you are in between the two trees, right? Which one you will choose? The right one or the left one? So you don't do it, you know, by taking a stick and measuring, oh, this one is closer. You are visually processing the info on the speed, on the distance, on the speed, on the distance, and then you are suddenly deciding upon what you will do. So we put a lot of confidence in our visual machinery. It was perfected through evolution. It was perfected so to extract patterns, so to extract certain things from the visual field, which is a really, really complicated thing, right? So, for example, information visualization just relies upon that. It is an example of processing the non-visual information through the visual machinery. The information was not meant to be visual, yet we visualize it so to process it through the visual. Okay, so let me give you some examples. I didn't invent it actually, unfortunately. Some examples of visual thinking by scientists. So this is a piece that was created by Maxwell in 1874. It was a plaster sculpture representing the relationship between the volume, entropy, and energy of a water-like substance. So the Maxwell was inspired by Gibbs' paper. And in this paper there were all sorts of thermodynamical relations between the quantities and how they should look like in order for the substance to have some properties, water-like properties. And Maxwell was so interested in it that he sculpted this thermodynamical surface in the abstract space. So this is abstract space, see? Entropy, energy, volume. It's not the physical space. He was processing the non-visual information through the visual apparatus, and it was really quite some time ago. He didn't have the 3D visualization equipment. He was making it from the plaster. This is again a case of processing a non-visual information through the visual hardware. He was even putting this model in certain relation to the light in order to see isolines on it. Right. This is a very nice example. And I read this interview with Feynman. You know, Feynman is famous for producing this visual aids to calculations, to perturbation calculations. And the guy was speaking to him and he said, what I'm really trying to do is to bring birth to clarity, which is really a half-assedly thought out pictorial semi-vision thing. I would see the jiggle, 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 or the wiggle of the path. Even now when I talk about the influence functional, I see the coupling and I take this turn like as if there was a big bag of stuff and try to collect. I mean, it's Feynman, it's a lot of superficial information coupled to real stuff, right? It's all visual. It's hard to explain. In some ways you see the answer, the character of the answer, absolutely, an inspired method of picturing, I guess. Ordinarily, I will try to get the pictures clearer, but in the end, the mathematics can take over. In the end, the mathematics can take over and be more efficient in communicating the idea of the picture. In certain particular problems that I have done, it was necessary to continue the development of the picture as the method, picture as the method, before the mathematics could be really done. So this is also processing the information through the visual before the onset of mathematical thinking. So I don't know whether you know about Nikola Tesla. He is a famous guy from these areas. But he was famous for seeing the motor in his mind. It appeared as a flash. He says, the idea came like a flash of lightning. And in an instant, the truth was revealed. I drew with a stick on the sand the diagrams shown 6 years later in my address before the American Institute of Electrical Engineers, and my companion understood them perfectly. The images I saw were wonderfully sharp and clear, and had the solidity of metal and stone, so much that I told him, see my motor here, watch me reverse it. So this is, when I read this, I was thinking about the graphic cards that we calculate on, right? So this is very popular these days. People do some matrix transformation or whatever that was meant for 3D transformation on the graphical hardware. So this sounds to me like processing the information through the visual hardware, similar as when we calculate on graphics cards. Okay, that's just a far-fetched analogy. Okay, but remember and beware. Visualization and visual can be misleading and deceiving. And that's quite often the case. Quite often the case. So let me tell you a story that happened to me a couple of weeks ago when I was driving to work. And I was really at that time thinking about this lecture. And so that's me driving. Okay, I'm looking at the scene. And I'm on the right half of the street, right? And this guy is already on the left part of the street. And so I can easily pass, you know, behind him. And this dog is going from the left side to the right side. Okay, so that's something like, it's not what I saw. I saw this. I saw I saw this. So this was the scene that I saw. And to my mind, I was immediately thinking, well, the dog is going to meet this guy. See, the tail is up, the head is up. He looks as if he's going to meet this guy. So I thought they were in some sort of a relation. Look at this. So I was thinking, this dog will come here. It will jump on this guy. They will all remain on the left side of the street. So I don't have to brake, right? I will just go on. I will just go behind this guy. Well, if I've seen something like this, I wouldn't have this idea. In this case, the tail is down, the head is down, it's almost the same image, see? But in this case, I would never think that this dog has something to do with this guy. I would just think, well, I really have to take care about this dog. He may cross the street. Well, it was like this. I saw this, so I was thinking, okay, I don't have to brake. Actually, this dog had nothing to do with this guy. So he was just like going through, and I had to, I mean, he's still alive, don't worry. So. But you see how really little details of the visual can get you into thinking wrong things. See this? And this. You know, it's a bit different. I put them on different levels here. See? You think differently. Well, the issue is only in details. Okay, so the visual can really be misleading because you are processing the visual information through your evolutionary machinery, through your cultural things that you know. You know that dogs and the people have some relation to each other, right? And so sometimes very small and subtle changes in a figure will have an enormous impact. And remember, always remember, that a lot of experiential, both visual and non-visual data is involved in interpretation of visual stimuli. Can be beneficial for scientific visualization, but can also lead to unwanted interpretations of scientific visualization. So I just want to tell you. the things that you see are really not out there. You know, the reality that you see is not really out there, right? So see this. Does it really move? I mean, it moves, right? For you, it moves. Do you see it moving around, or is the lightning is wrong? You see? So what does it tell you? It tells you that the things that you're receiving are not really the things that are out there. So it's depressive. It's kind of depressing, right? Because we are processing the visual data. We are constantly processing it. You're looking at this point, and it looks fairly stationary. But then the things from the sides start moving on, because the brain is picking things from the visual field. And as it's doing that, it's producing all sorts of distortions. Right? So the visual should be taken with care, because it's not reality. I don't know whether you see it or not. I saw it quite nice. You see it, huh? So it says, you know when you shouldn't be driving. So try to follow the line from the bar to your home. You know when you shouldn't be driving. Okay. So the visual is dangerous. We can always excite some things that we didn't really count upon. Okay, so remember, we are seeing with the brain. We are not seeing with the eyes. The information that we get is hugely processed. And the things we see are not really the things that are out there. And always remember that the image that you produce will be processed, filtered through evolution, experience, and possibly even culture. Okay. So now that I told you some basic things about scientific visualization, let me give you some historically, really, really brief historical examples of scientific visualization. So, of course, people have always tried to visualize things. Imagine people in the Stone Age, in the caves, they were visualizing bulls or whatever, and horses, and so it was probably not a scientific sort of visualization, but as soon as people started creating models of reality, like religions, myths, or science, there appeared a need for more abstract visualization of things. So in this case, it's 10th or 11th century, the guy is illustrating different phases of the moon. So it is a Iranian or Persian script, and you see a pretty nice example of scientific visualization with black and red color and white regions and lines, and it's very nice. So 1,000 years ago, people really knew what to do with that, right? So, of course, map making was an example of scientific visualization. So you're visualizing geography, you're visualizing a lot of knowledge that came from people who traveled, right? So here you can see a part of the world that was known to Al-Idrisi. It's 12th century. I think he was hired to do this. I think he got a lot of money for that. And of course, some people that we know of, like Kepler, he was, see this, he was visualizing the Archimedean solids. So these are solids that have two different polygons, regular polygons at sites, and or even more. I'm not sure. Primož, what is the proper definition of Archimedean solid? Okay, so there are 13 of them, and see how he used shading to show the three-dimensional nature of these things. I mean, it's Kepler. He was not trained as the artist, or maybe he heard some courses like you are now listening to. But he still tried to, you know, do these regions of the shapes that are in deep shadow. Then he was doing this in the mid-shadow, right? Soft shadows, highlights on this side. So he was really giving the illusion of three-dimensional nature of these objects in his publications. And there is a story about Galileo. I don't know whether you know, but the Galileo was not the first guy who saw the moon through the telescope. It was some other guy, Thomas Harriot, who said that he noted only strange spottedness in the veining of the crescent. So you usually see a lot of topographical data in the region where the shadow meets the light. So most topographical data is seen here. But was ignorant to the cause. So this was copied from Wikipedia. They quote the sources, so you can check it out. Galileo, due in part to his artistic training and the knowledge of chiaroscuro, had understood the patterns of light and shadow were in fact topological markers. Galileo was the first to deduce the cause of the uneven veining as light occlusion from lunar mountains and craters. So see how he draws them here. He knows what he sees. It's not enough to see. One should learn to see. Learning to see, right? In his study, he also made topological charts estimating the heights of the mountains. So had Galileo not have some artistic training and had he not been able to draw, he could never, you know, explain what he saw to his fellow scientists. So this was the case where the artistry, where the knowledge of drawing, where the skills of drawing had a lot of influence on the development of science. Of course, I was always thinking, imagine Galileo looking at the moon and seeing something like this. Okay. So I want to introduce a guy that I call the saint of scientific visualization. You know, in Catholic Christianity, people, they have saints, like saint for small kids, or saint for storms, or that will save people from the storms, or saint that will save people from the fires, and they are good for all sorts of things. But in science, I sometimes imagine people who are saints in science, like saint of doubt, right? Or a saint of fair play, scientific fair play, right? Or whatever, imagine who would it be in your interpretation, who would be that guy? And I call this guy the saint of scientific visualization, because I think he really contributed a lot to scientific visualization, and he may be the first guy who really shown all there is to know about scientific visualization. Leonardo da Vinci. Most people, of course, know him for Mona Lisa and the paintings he did, right? But he's also famous as an inventor, and he also even tried to be an architect. Michelangelo always told about him that he's talking more than he can produce, which was kind of true. So most of his things were never realized, and a lot of that remained only in plans and drawings. But these were some drawings, right? So at that time, they were trying to produce the best possible representation of body, to sell it, of course, better. So they were studying on corpses. Leonardo did it, Michelangelo also did it. But when you look at some of these drawings, they are really spectacular in a way. Imagine Leonardo didn't see all this visual richness that we have today. But look at what he was doing. He was cutting, of course, he was cutting in real life also, so that was not a particularly far-fetched imagination that was required to do that. But, you know, he was doing something that we typically do today when we are visualizing things. Peeling layers of reality to show the essence, right? We make cut-throughs. And there are some things like insects. See here? He's studying the details of placenta here or whatever. See? Small sketches, and you see the shading, trying to emphasize the three-dimensional nature of the things that he's drawing, right? This is a very, very good visualization of the thing. You get a lot of information from looking at it. So the idea was to see the essence, to see below the surface. They look like scientific sketches, see? He's even disassembling them, assembling them, showing how they join together, showing different pieces in contact. So the idea is to disassemble the system in order to show its parts, their connectivity and interaction. It's the same as we do in science, right? Now look at this. It's a really advanced cross-sectional visualization of a skull. So he's drawing a skull here, and you see he's shading it properly. You see the shadows, you see topographical features of the skull. But on the left portion, on the left half of the skull, he's making a cross-section, cutaway piece. See here? He's showing the cross-section through the teeth, eyes, see, forehead, sinuses, nose. See, it's a very modern sort of a visualization. To remove the parts of the system which get in the way of uncovering the essence. To choose a cross-section of the 3D shape which shows its nature in the clearest possible manner. So that's the idea. And in this case, he's showing the same system from different viewpoints. See? He's rotating the subject so that its three-dimensional nature, its essence, becomes clear. Also very clever. Something that looks pretty modern. Something that looks better than the things that Guy has shown you with several representations of the same thing. The idea is to see clearly, of course. And he was also a master of map making. So this is the plan, the map of Imola. I mean, the map making was, of course, known in his times, but in several aspects this was original. He was visualizing the streets in the city. So trying to see as clearly as possible. The idea was to pick a viewpoint not innate to a human, to pick a viewpoint of a bird, an angel, in order to see the real essence of the system. It's not the city that you usually see, right? So this is the idea. It's not the city that you see, but the city as you would see it, were you a bird. Right? So imagine if we could see the solar system from some far point, right? And you would see how the Earth goes around the Sun, how the Moon goes around the Earth, and all the planets goes around the Sun. So all of these centuries of fighting about the heliocentric system or the system where the Earth, right, geocentric system, would be completely out of the question. So if you could choose a viewpoint where you could see the nature of the system clearly, then a lot of fighting, a lot of quarrel would be for nothing, because everybody would see it, right? So he's also famous for botanical illustration, of course. He used it for his paintings, but most of them have also a scientific quality. The proportions are right, the shadows are right. Some of it is stylized, like here, but it's pretty good. It's pretty a realistic representation of nature. Here you see a topographic chart, something like a topographic chart, rivers or whatever. So maybe this is also the interesting piece. I think Leonardo never published anything of his illustrations, but this was done for Luca Pacioli's book about geometry, where Leonardo, Luca Pacioli was his friend, so Leonardo offered him some services in scientific visualization, visualizing some of the polyhedra that Pacioli wanted to show. But this is the real point of a creativity of a genius. So Leonardo knew if he would show the full polyhedra, a lot of information would be lost, because you would see only something that is just in front of you, right? You wouldn't see the back of this polyhedra. So what he thought of was to cut the pieces from the sides and do it consistently on all the sides so that you could see through the shape. So it's again the idea where you are removing, like in his anatomical illustrations, you're removing the parts of the system in order to see clearly. If you need to, you remove what you don't need, okay? If you need to, you just remove it. So here's what is said about it. Da Vinci supplied two views, a plain view and a vacua or empty view, which I'm showing now, where he removed the sides to better reveal the complete structure of the polyhedron. These nets of vertices and edges illustrate the artist's graphic genius. So I would agree with that. See, in this way you really see the topology, the connectivity of a polyhedron. Okay, so remember, always choose the visual representation which clearly shows what you want to say, even if it means blurring some other elements of reality, whatever that means, as Leonardo did with cutting, not showing the whole polyhedral surface. So sometimes you have to get rid of some elements of reality in order to better understand the essence of reality. That is what we do in physics, right? We are modeling things, knowing that we throw out a lot of things that are really out there, right? But we are trying to find the essence of things by showing only those pieces that we think are important. So it's the same in scientific visualization. Choose a visual representation which clearly shows what you want to say, even if you have to throw out something. Okay, so biologists and chemists and structural biologists knows how to do it. See here, so this is the all atom representation of some protein, triose phosphate isomerase, right? And when you look at it in this way, showing all the chemical bonds, color-coded, you really don't see much, right? So it's a proper three-dimensional representation, everything is good, everything is, you even have some shadowing here, self-shadowing, whatever, but you don't see a lot. On the other hand, when you choose to pick up the elements of reality that are important, like alpha helices and beta strands, right, beta sheets here, then you start to see some order in it. you are not really doing anything forbidden. You're just picking out the patterns that are already there. This piece has information. This piece has not. Does not have information. This one has something that you want to say. It has a regular arrangement of alpha helices, and you see the barrel-like arrangement of beta sheets in there. Right. So it's 3 o'clock. Maybe we should make a break. Huh? Good. Okay.